right, y'all. Welcome, everyone, to Saki Speaking Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. Y'all, please do me a favor and show my moderator, Love Jones, some love and affection moving in the right direction. And please make sure that you like the video on your way in the door. Make sure you drop in the chat box and say, hey, girl, hey. And if you have social media, go ahead and share this video. Some other people might want to get into this man's business too, okay? But let's not all be driven crazy by ourselves. And if you haven't already, which I'm not sure why you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel, making sure to click the notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the Speakeasy is open for business. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to my little janky podcast. I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers and those of you catching this on the replay. Thank you for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way that y'all love on me. So let's see who these nosy heifers are that came back to kick it with me for a few minutes and see what's happening with Ethic and Alani. Child, y'all cannot get enough of these folks. And some of y'all sitting through this shit for the second time because y'all done read it already. But y'all just want to share the experience with me, and I appreciate you guys for that. Hey, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. Welcome back, darling. Thank you so much for coming back. I appreciate you. I'm scrolling. Let me see. Oh, wait a minute. We got somebody new. Well, hello, Mary. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome. And Hashitashi Grasshopper, welcome, learning. Thank you so much for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Thank you, Nordic, for coming back one more again today. I appreciate you, darling. Welcome, welcome. And the same to you, Marva. Welcome back, darling, with your nosy ass. Hey, Kay, I see you're here, darling. Thank you. Thank you for coming back. Welcome back, darling. Thank you so much for coming back. I appreciate you. Welcome. Welcome. And I think I got everybody, right? Yes, I did. I got everybody. All right. Listen, y'all. Let me get my little time stamp, y'all. Because my sister act like she just couldn't let me get a slow bop in second, y'all. I wanted to be a slow bopper for Christ for a second and take a break from this shit. But she said, I'll get it, since you seem to be struggling. So today, we're reading Ethic Book 5. And the synopsis reads, life has never been easy for Ethic. Since he was a young boy, he has battled loss after loss while struggling to navigate through a treacherous world. When he met Alani Lenika Hill, he knew that he had met the woman who would love him back to life. They have weathered a storm together, and their love is so fated that neither want to let it go. But it seems their bubble of happiness is an illusion, because the life around them is falling apart. When Morgan Atkins attempts suicide, their bliss is shattered. So much is on the line. So many things hang in the balance as Morgan fights for her life. Her broken heart has led her to this, but if she dies, the soul of Ethic's family will be buried with her. In this heart-pounding series, fans have been written into a world of love, lust, anger, sadness, joy, hate, and most of all, growth. Hold on tight for another installment of this epic love story told in such a poignant way that it's hard to distinguish the real world from the one in your head. Welcome back to the Ethic Effect. Charles. Here we go. Previously, on the Ethic Effect. John Morgan done sat her ass in a car and put a damn hose through the window and started, it was an old school joint. Okay, you know, one of them probably like maybe a 85 Regal, child. You know the kind with a carburetor. Oh my God, and she done put the damn, and put a, I guess some sort of hose from the exhaust into the window, child, and let the window up. And she done sat her simple ass in the car, child, trying to wipe herself off the planet. She wanted to blow out her own candle, child, because she's all in her fifis, because Messiah, right? I refuse to say that nigga name like that, because Messiah is just, you know, he'd been on the warpath, child. Listen, he'd been a cruddy-ass nigger. That's what he been. He was sent to kill Ethic, dispatched since he was a young buck to kill Ethic. He has ingratiated himself into the Okafor gang, honey, and been drilling in Morgan's coochie and done planted a seed. And now she, her life just is falling apart because she done found out the truth of who he really is, and she just can't believe it. Her can't handle it. She just weak at the knees. Her soul said, fuck it, I'm checking out. It's checkout time. That's not funny. That's horrible. I'm going to hell. And this is a character in a book, man. That damn girl is crazier than 10 tiny people on meth. Anyway, so everybody's at the hospital now. They done put her in a hyperbaric chamber, child, to try to give her some pure oxygen therapy, hopefully to bring her back to life. I'm assuming that they have found out that she's with child. I don't know what the hell they're going to do. I guess Ethic going to go looking for Messiah. I don't know what's going to happen, but we all going to find out a little bit of it tonight. Y'all are going to have me up here half the night. I know you have this line. Mm-mm. No, ma'am. I'm just going to be up here for a little bit, give y'all a little something-something, a little Texas two-step right quick, and then we're going to dash on up out of here and let y'all enjoy the rest of y'all evening. Chapter 1. Have you heard anything, Nanny? Bella asked as she entered the kitchen. You say good morning when you wake up and join the rest of us, little girl, Nanny said as she turned from the stove with a plate in her hand. Yes, ma'am, Bella answered. Good morning. She took a seat in the chair across from Easy. Good morning, baby, Nanny answered, kissing the top of Bella's head. No, I haven't heard anything new. She hasn't opened her eyes yet, but we just gonna keep praying. Nanny placed the home-cooked breakfast in front of Bella. Grits, homemade biscuits, bacon, and eggs. A plate full of effort, especially from Nanny's old bones. It all took so much effort, which equated to love. Child, listen, Nanny, you slide me a plate right now, I'll fuck some shit up and be grateful and wash the dishes up after and mop the kitchen floor. I know you lying. When you're done, I want you to go down to the corner store and put my numbers in. I'm going to send you with a note and the money. Jimmy knows me down there. All you got to do is give it to him and he'll do the rest, Nanny said. Yes, ma'am, Bella said. Nanny, what if Mo doesn't wake up? Is a coma the same as dying? Easy asked. It's a coma, idiot, Bella snapped. Don't talk to your brother like that, Nanny said. Ever, she reinforced. You speak out of love or not at all when you're talking to family. Bella's head hung low as she played in her food, unable to stomach much because she was wound so tightly with anxiety. Yes, ma'am. Would they have to, like, put her in the ground like my mom? Easy pressed. He just wanted information. Bella, too. They were in anguish over the uncertainty of Morgan's condition. We're not there yet, baby. God sits a person down sometimes when they need to rest. When you're doing too much, God will come and take your legs right from under you and give you a little nap. She's resting. We're going to pray really hard because she still has a lot of life to live and a lot of people who love her. Don't you worry. God is in the miracle granting business, Nanny said. Bella picked up her fork and Nanny cleared her throat. Bless your food, Nanny reminded. Bella lowered her head. God, please, this isn't about the food. I mean, yeah, bless the food and the hands that prepared it, but please don't let Mo die. God, please, please. I'm begging you, take a little life away from me and just give it to her. Just let her wake up. She lifted her head. Amen. Bella picked at her plate. When she was done, she washed the dishes, a rule at Nanny's and Alani's, before grabbing the note and heading out the door. Her heart was so heavy that her legs almost couldn't carry it. She felt an unbelievable burden on her soul and her chest ached. As soon as she was up the block, her tears came. She tried not to cry in front of Easy because she didn't want to scare him. She had held these tears in for days. The waiting was unbearable. If Morgan died, Bella would be crushed. Morgan was her sister. She had shared moments with Mo that no one else knew about. They had secrets between them that they had shared under the same cover with a flashlight in the middle of the night. They had argued and made up 1,000 times over the years. Bella looked up to Morgan. She had never seen anyone prettier, never met anyone smarter. She used to love when they would be in a room full of people and sign the entire time. They had their own bond, their own understanding, and they had never let anyone else in. Sisters by love, not blood, it still counted. And if Morgan died, Bella would never forgive her. She made it to the corner store. It was graffiti covered and had bars on the windows. The glass door was so dirty it was no longer see-through. She walked inside and headed straight for the counter. "What can I do for you, darling?" the Chaldean man asked as he stood behind the counter. "Miss Pat sent me," she said. She handed him the handwritten note. He opened the paper and read it. "Coming right up." He typed the numbers into the machine and then handed her a stack of tickets. "That'll be $28. Bella handed him two 20s and then accepted her change. "Do you have seltzer water and veggie straws?" she asked. He snickered. "Nah, little mama, I ain't got that. I got quarter waters in the back. Fago Pops and hot Cheetos and shit over there." Bella grimaced, sticking out her tongue in disgust as she shook her head. "You too good for hot Cheetos, pretty girl." She turned toward the voice, turned too quickly to play it cool, and Hendrix scoffed in amusement, smiling at her eagerness. He stepped up and tossed $5 on the counter. "Two hot Cheetos, a pickle, and a Rillo," he said. "Give me two quarter waters, too, and some now and laters." Hendrix pulled off another $5 and then turned to Bella. "You gonna eat all that?" she asked, frowning. "Nah, you're gonna help me," he said. "You gotta act like you from the hood if you gonna be parlaying in the hood." He licked his lips and she shook her head. "You got it, G," Jimmy said as he slid a brown paper bag across the counter. Hendrix grabbed it and walked out the store. He let the door swing closed and Bella stopped walking. He turned back, noticing she was still inside the store. His brow dipped low in confusion and he pulled the door open. "What's wrong?" he asked. "When you're walking with me, I don't open my own doors," she said. He stared at her for a beat, then pulled his bottom lip between his teeth. He opened the door wider and extended his hand. I hear you. Now a nigga know better. I'll do better," he said. Bella eased out in front of him. "I'll take you back to Miss Pat's," he said, nodding toward the car parked in front of them. It was an old-school box-style car from the 80s. It reminded her of the ones Ethic would buy from the junkyard in rehab. It was rusted in places where the winter had eaten away at the body and in bad shape. "This is your car?" she asked. "Yeah, you too good to ride in my Chevy? I know you used to Teslas and all. I'm a grind up one day. I'm a get that too. But you got to be willing to ride in this to sit in that with me one day. From the bottom. Feel me?" he asked. "Who said I wanted to sit next to you at all?" Bella asked. Hendrix smiled and nodded his head. "Just let me take you back," he said. "Please? I can't pull up with you to Nanny. She'd kill me. Then my dad would kill me. Then Alani would bury my body because she doesn't play at all," Bella said, only half joking. "Are you even old enough to be driving?" "I don't follow rules too good," he smirked, looking off down the block before rolling charming eyes back at her. He was so damn cute. Gorgeous, in fact. Bella tore her gaze from his and forced it to her feet. She shuffled from side to side. "I'll drop you off at the corner. Get in," he said. Bella knew better than to follow him, but her feet moved anyway. They hopped in the car, and he dumped the junk from the paper bag. He popped open a bag of hot Cheetos. "Veggie straws," he snickered. "This is real nigga food." She jerked her neck back as he held the bag up to her face. "It smells like feet a little bit," she said with a chuckle. "Come on, man. Get your G up," he said. "Taste one." He stuck his hand inside the bag and popped a handful in his mouth. "They good as fuck. No lie," he said. Bella stuck her pinky out and dipped two dainty fingers inside the bag. She pulled out one Cheeto and put it in her mouth. Her eyebrows lifted in surprise as she chewed slow. "Ah," he teased. "Good as fuck, right?" She smiled and snatched the bag. "Give me those," she said. "Pretty girl, ain't that bougie, huh?" She stuck out her tongue. "They're hot." He passed her a quart of water and she popped her thumb through the aluminum and drank a sip. "Look at you, looking like a regular round the way girl," he teased. He grabbed the cigarillo and opened the package before gutting it. He pulled out a small bag of weed. "Can you not do that with me in your car?" she asked. "You don't smoke? My bad," he said. "Good girl shit. I forgot. I mean, I have before. I don't often, but I just don't want to go back smelling like it," she said. "I got you," he said. He started the car and drove the short distance to Nanny's block. He pulled over at the end of the block as promised. Cut off the engine. "How old are you, Hendrix?" she asked. 14, he said. "And you're 13 in 3 months," he added. She nodded. "Who made you cry?" he asked. Bella looked at him in stone, thrown off by his question. "Your eyes are red and glossy, a little puffy. Who I gotta fuck up? Why would you mess up anyone just because they made me cry?" she countered. He shrugged. "That's just how I'm cut. Fuck shit up over what I feel like fucking shit up over. Over you, it feel like I'm gonna be fucking up a lot of shit." She looked out the window, fighting an unexpected smile. Her chest went warm like it did when she swallowed hot chocolate, and then it faded. My sister's in the hospital. She tried to kill herself, and I don't know if she's gonna be okay, Della admitted. That's messed up, he said, a heavy note in his voice as he stared out the window. He rolled sympathetic eyes back to her. I gotta go, she said. Thanks for the snacks. She smiled, and he opened his car door. Where are you going? She asked. You said you don't touch doors when you with me. Car doors count, right? Bella smiled. Yeah, they count. She waited in the passenger seat until he got to her door and opened it. She stood and looked at him. He stood in front of her, trapping her between his body and his raggedy car. 13 in 3 months. Why do you keep bringing that up? She asked. Because that's when I'm gonna kiss you, on your birthday, when you're 13, he said. Suddenly, it was scorching outside and Bella's stomach went missing. Her phone rang and Bella answered it immediately when she saw her father's face on the screen. Daddy, she paused, and then her eyes widened before she pushed past Hendrick and took off running full speed toward Nanny's house. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, I guess he up the block. Oh my God. Uh-oh, y'all. Okay. That's a mess, child. Listen, Linda. I don't even. Here she is. He's 14. I mean, that ain't strange for a 14-year-old to be driving in the hood, child. I done seen some 12-year-olds driving in the hood. Shit, I was a 12-year-old. I can't trip. Not at all. Oh, my God. Not a deuce and a quarter. Listen, child, I don't know what kind of car it was. Do we know what kind of car it was? She just said one of his old school cars. So, yeah. Yes, higher than a midget on a kite, child. Listen. Hey, Kim Cash, welcome back, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right, let's see. Where we at? Uh-oh, Kim Bird is back in the building. Hey, Love Muffin, welcome back. Thank you so much for coming back. Yes, indeed. Not Young Thug life. Better leave Bella alone. Okay? Well, he fuck around and come up missing, child. He know who her daddy is, so he better tread lightly. Very lightly. Child, listen. All right, let's get to this next chapter. Chapter 2. Where the hell is this girl? Arya whispered. She glanced at her phone screen briefly, snatching eyes from the road ahead as she tried to dial Morgan and drive simultaneously. Hi, you've reached Morgan Atkins. Leave a message that'll make me smile. Beep. Mo, Arya shouted in the phone. You know I thrive off attention, sis. Where's my attention? It's been 2 days since I've heard your voice. You know I'm not the one to be ignored. I stopped by your place. You're not home. So I'm taking that as a reason to slide by your fine-ass daddy house to see if you're there. Ooh, child, that man is fine. I just want to be your stepmama. My God, why is he so fine? Arya snickered into the phone as she maneuvered onto the highway. Okay, I know you're probably disgusted at this point. You better be there. Got me wasting my gas driving all the way to Grand Blanc because you don't want to answer your phone. I'll be there soon. Love you. Bye. Listen, she leaving messages and shit like me. I be talking my ass off to nobody. Okay? Arya hung up, and as soon as she sat her phone down, it rang loudly through her speakers. Mo Money, a.k.a. Main Thing, a.k.a. My Bitch. The name popped up on the screen in her car. Arya pressed answer. About time you answered. Hello, Arya. This is Alani. Morgan's... There was a pause and Arya frowned. I'm a friend of her father. Morgan is hurt. She's... Arya heard the emotion stuck in Alani's throat. The hint of a sob was leaking through the speakers. She's in the hospital. Hurley Medical Center. You should come here. Arya's heart obliterated in her chest. The sinking feeling that consumed her was so overwhelming that she had to pull over. Her foot shook against the accelerator and tears filled her eyes. She didn't even need to hear more. She recognized the anguish in Alani's voice. She could hear the worry, the fear. She had no inclination of what had occurred, but she knew it was bad. What happened? She asked. Is she okay? We don't know yet, hon, but you should get here, Ethic said. Ethic said she would want you here, Alani said. We're on the 7th floor, room 10. I'm on my way, Arya answered. Arya? Alani called. There was a pause, and then the sound of a cry that sent a pang of fear through Arya's belly. Hurry, The line went dead, and Aria's eyes prickled. Her lip quivered, and she gripped her steering wheel so tightly that the pads of her fingers hurt. Her mind flashed to the last time she'd seen Morgan, the dance studio, the practice. You make sure Messiah knows that this is all his fault. Morgan's words played through Aria's head as she pressed her foot to the gas, all the way to the floor, causing her to spin out a bit as she maneuvered back onto the road. She knew. She hadn't known before that moment, but after this phone call from Alani, she was sure Morgan had hurt herself. Morgan had put all her value in the basket of Messiah, and the bottom had fallen out of it. Fucking Messiah, she whispered. Her eyes clouded the entire way down the highway, but she kept driving. She might as well have been flying. She was driving so fast. She picked up her phone, struggling to keep her sights on the road, and dial Issa at the same time. The number you've dialed is no longer in service. Aria's heart plummeted. She tossed the phone in her handbag and hightailed it to Flint. Aria wasn't a girl who made friends easily. She didn't trust women. She didn't love women, but Morgan was her sister. They developed such a strong bond in such a short period of time that it felt like her own flesh and blood was hurting. Aria could feel it in her soul. She was such an empath that she had tossed and turned all night. Something in her had been unsettled, and now she knew why. She couldn't get to her fast enough, and when she pulled into the hospital, she didn't even park her car. She hopped out right at the entrance. Ma'am, you can't park there. The words were spoken to her back because she was already inside. Everything seemed to take forever. The security guard checking her bag, the elevator descending slowly from the top floor. It was torture. Aria just wanted to get to her. She just wanted to see her. When she made it to the seventh floor, she had to brace herself. She had to clench her stomach to stop the sob from bursting through her trembling lips. She could see Easy and Bella sitting on the floor at the far end of the hall. She could see a beautiful woman, whom she assumed to be Alani, pacing around them. Aria's steps quickened. She was counting them. She was so anxious. When she got to the trio, she stopped. She gulped in air, not realizing she had been holding her breath until that very moment. Aria? She nodded. Come on, Alani said. She placed a soft hand to Aria's shoulder and led her inside the room. Oh, no, Aria said, turning around right into Alani, collapsing into her as she clenched her eyes tight. No, why would he do this to her? How could he do this to her? Aria, who prided herself in never letting anyone see her sweat, folded under pressure. Under the pressure of possibly losing the only friend she had ever had. I know, Alani whispered, I know. Aria didn't even know Alani, but this embrace was the only thing keeping her standing. This hug felt like it came from a woman who cared, and she clung to her until she gained her composure. She turned to the bed where Ethic was sitting, head bowed over intertwined fists. Aria couldn't even admire Mo's fine-ass daddy or the fine-ass man sitting on the other side of Morgan, head bowed in prayer also because she was so focused on the tube running out of Morgan's parted lips. Her face was swollen, her throat bloated, and her skin so pale that it looked blue. I'm gonna beat Messiah's ass. She walked to Morgan's bedside. What happened to her? What did she do? Ethic lifted a penetrating stare to Aria. What do you mean, what did she do? What makes you think she did this? Ethic asked. She knew he was upset. She knew he was looking for someone to blame. She knew that her implying that Mo did it meant she had prior knowledge of the possibility of her doing exactly this. Ethic was looking for explanation, reaching for someone to blame, searching for someone to punish. The last time I saw her, Aria stammered, she was upset. She was emotional. She said to tell Messiah it was on him. I had no idea she would do something this stupid. Why would she do this? Mo, how could you do this to yourself? Ethic stood and allowed Aria to sit beside Morgan. She reached for her hand. Is she going to be okay? She looked back at Ethic, who stood behind Alani with his arms draping over her, leaning on her as his red eyes stared at Morgan. We don't know, Alani answered. We're praying hard. Aria turned to the man across from her, gold chain on his neck, fitted decap on his head, dimples in his cheeks that she wanted to stick her tongue in. This is Nair, our pastor and a friend, Alani introduced. You're a pastor? Like a pastor? Aria asked, lifting eyes of surprise. Like, bless the food, take my tithes, preach a word type of pastor? Nair gave a half smirk and a nod of confirmation. I do all of the above, he said. Where the fuck they make you at? Aria asked. Nigga, I'll lay all this on your altar. Alani hollered, Ethic too. It was the first laugh that had infiltrated the somber hospital room in days. So wait, Nair must be fine. Okay. Nair licked his lips and smiled while shaking his head. He was used to this type of response. No one had ever been this blatant, but it wasn't foreign. Arya couldn't help but chuckle. Sorry, Pastor, I'm just saying. I'm a sinner. I'm in need of prayer. Closed door confession, sir. Nair lifted from his seat. On that note, I think I'm a slide G, he said. You better, Arya mumbled. Listen. Arya, my type of chick, she like, listen, I'll lay it low and spread it wide for you, pastor. Your fine ass. Naya showed ethic love, hands clasped, a quick hug, a gangster's handshake, before kissing Alani's cheek and then making his exit. Arya sighed. Simo, you got me out here talking crazy to men of God. Wake up, sis. You're the calms in my crazy. Wake your ass up before I fuck your pastor. Her jokes were only her way of distracting herself from the seriousness of the situation. Not before I fuck your pastor. Oh my God. It was easier to laugh than to cry, but as a tear slid down her face and she reached for Mool's cold hand, she knew that this was one time she wouldn't be able to play tough. Her heart was on her sleeve and would remain there until Morgan opened her eyes. Wake up, Mo. Please, God, let her wake up. And there's a break in the chat. Child, listen, I cannot argue with you. Oh my goodness, child. Listen, Linda, I cannot. Yes, the seventh floor, room 10. That makes it. Well, it's probably room 710, but yeah, that's just how they do that. Hey, Choco Chip, welcome back, darling. Thank you so much for sliding back into the speakeasy and bringing the good vibes with you. Welcome. Child, listen. Yes, she said that before I fuck your pastor. Listen, child. All right. The darkness of night cloaked the block as Messiah sat on the front porch of the old one-story house. The idea of knocking on the front door and stepping foot inside made his heart riot inside his chest. Messiah didn't fear much. He had been through hell. After the things he had endured, every other threat held no power over him. These four walls, the memories that dwell inside, the ghosts he had run from, they terrified him. They paralyzed him right on the stoop. He couldn't take a step further. It was taking everything inside him to be there. He didn't know how Rosie could live there. She had gone back to buy the property as soon as he had blessed her with her first bag. She was like an agent, taking 15% off the top of all his licks simply because she was his bloodline. He always took care of his bloodline. A real man did nothing less. So when he got paid, she got paid. Every time, on time. She was his sister, and he had tried his best to do right by her, out of obligation. Not love, because he hadn't allowed himself to love anyone his entire life. It was why Morgan's love had snuck up on him. It had jumped him, delivering blows to his chin, kicks to his middle, folding him like a little bitch with nothing more than a smile and the sound of his name on her lips. Morgan had beat him black and blue with her love. He felt the bruises even now. They throbbed unbearably. He loved her so terribly, even still, even knowing he couldn't stay. Even if he wanted to, he couldn't stay with her. The possibility of that possibility wasn't even in his power anymore. He was leaving her, and the realization that the day had finally come made tears of anger burden his eyes. He would do anything to stay, but he couldn't. His head hung low, locks blocking out the bums straggling down the street. The sound of the bottles clanging inside the grocery cart he pushed serenaded the otherwise quiet street. Messiah was in a dreadful mood. He had to blow town. He should have been left town. If Ethic found out he was still in the city's limits, there would be no bullets spared. He had to do this one thing first. He didn't want to, but lately his choices weren't his own. The headlights that shined on him pulled his attention. Rosie Williams was home, his little sister. He remembered the day his mother had brought her home. He didn't know how he remembered. He was only 3 years old, but he could vividly see her walking into his room, carrying a little crying bundle. Meet your sister, Messiah. This is Rosie. Wosie, he had asked. Wosie is my sister. Wosie is your sister, and you're her big brother. You'll have to protect her. You'll have to be strong for her. Nobody comes before her. If you ever have to choose, you choose her. My Wosie. Oh, he couldn't say Rosie when he was a kid, so he called her Wosie. Oh, Messiah. But fuck you, though, nigga. Anyway, Messiah had imprinted on her instantly. That sense of responsibility had settled into him from day one. He had loved her back then, before trauma happened, before love made him feel weak, before he associated loving someone with pain, before the love of Bookie had turned to something sadistic, something cruel, something unimaginable. After that, he had been afraid to let anyone love him. He had been terrified to love at all. He wanted no parts of it. Love felt like manipulation. Love was the precursor to abuse. Love was the way Bookie had gotten Messiah to trust him before robbing him of everything that made him a man. Fuck love. So he wouldn't love Rosie if he wanted to. Protect her? Yes. Love her? He couldn't. He just couldn't. Rosie exited the car and then reached into the back seat to retrieve her child. Messiah, he's gone. Daddy's gone, she cried, hopping out of the car. She snatched open the back door and pulled out her son, his nephew, another attached unattachment. He didn't move immediately. He sat there brooding, contemplating, struggling as she stormed over to him. What the fuck you just sitting there for? Did you hear me? I got a call from the Department of Corrections, Messiah. He's gone. He was fine. He was in perfect health. All of a sudden, he's dead. And I've been wondering why he hasn't called, why he hasn't checked in. He's dead. He's been dead for days, and they are just now calling. That nigga Epic did this. I hope he kissed all his fucking kids goodnight last night because every single one of them is fucking dead. Why are you just sitting there? Do you hear me? It's time to put this shit to rest. Messiah stood. Quit all that fucking yelling, Wo. You're being reckless right now. Open the door. Rosie was so emotional that her hands shook as she put the key in the lock and opened her door. Messiah followed her inside. I'm so glad you done with that bitch. It's about time you came to your senses. I'm gonna make that shit hurt. I want her in pieces, Messiah. She looks exactly like her sister. Exactly. I fucking hate her. I want her dead. The adrenaline that coursed through him as he put the burner to her lower back and pulled the trigger made his heart race. Wosie lost her legs as the bullet ripped through her. No sound because Messiah knew better. Silence the shot. Two pulls of the trigger, one body, one headshot to make sure it was finished. Get in and out. But she was his sister. He couldn't just let her body hit the floor. He was having a hard time even curling his finger a second time for the kill shot. He caught her as she stumbled backwards onto him. She gripped her child, and he gripped her, staggering to the wall and then sliding down as she gritted her teeth, gasping for air. Messiah, she groaned, crying. He squeezed his eyes closed, pulling her head back to his shoulder as his nephew screamed in the arms of his dying mother. Shh, he whispered in her ear, stroking her hair as his heart bled. How could you? She cried, coughing. Miss blood spurted from her mouth. Why? For her. He whispered. He kissed the side of Rosie's head as she kicked her feet, trying to push against him, trying to fight for her life. Her lungs were filling with blood. She was suffocating. She was drowning on dry land. Messiah, her brother, her flesh and blood, had shot her. I told you not to make me choose, Wo. If you're alive, she's always in danger. She's never safe. I can't stay to keep her safe, but I can't leave her. If you are alive, I can't, Woe. She's mine. I'll sacrifice anything for her. Even you, Woe. It was you or her. I'm so sorry. My son, she cried. My baby, Messiah, my son. I got him, Wosie. Just sleep. Just close your eyes, he whispered. Just like when we were little. Close them, Woe. He gritted his teeth and put her head to his chest. His fucking eyes burned. He was at war with himself. He felt like a monster. Morgan had peeled back so many layers of his soul, he felt everything, every second of Wosie's life leaving her. He felt that shit and it was excruciating. Her son wailed in her arms as Messiah held her tightly. Just like that, Wosie. He lifted the gun to her temple and turned his head away. If he could have handled this any other way, he would have. If he could leave. And be confident that Wosie would never seek revenge against Morgan. He would have let her live. He knew his sister, however. She was a menace, and once she had spoken the threat against Morgan, it was written that she would kill her. Wosie didn't make idle threats. She didn't speak without thinking. It would only be a matter of time before she touched Morgan, so Messiah touched her first. He couldn't do much for Mo at this point, but he could take care of that. He could clear the danger out of her path. He was struck between the blood that coursed in his veins, the DNA he couldn't help, and the blood that pumped his heart. Morgan made his heart race. She gave him purpose. He would never not choose her. No matter how difficult a decision it may be, he would lay anybody to rest for her, over her, because of her. Morgan was justification enough to commit murder and condemn his soul to hell. He didn't give a fuck. As long as she was covered, he knew his mistakes made him less of a lesser man than the one who was supposed to possess someone as pure as Morgan. He was figuring out life the hard way, through trial and error, making up logic that justified his wrongs, because in his mind, this was right. It was Morgan's law, Messiah's will. Just do it. Messiah curled the trigger. Wolsey's body went limp in his arms, and Messiah laid her down gently. He bent to pick up his nephew. "I know, man, I know," he whispered. He grabbed the diaper bag from the floor and placed it over his arm. "Shh, shh, fuck I'ma do with you, nephew, huh? What I'm supposed to do now," he whispered, bouncing as he stepped over Wolsey's body. He didn't look back as he made his exit. And that's the end of that chapter. Well, now, I don't even, child, listen, Linda, I don't even know what to say right now. Not Aria must be a Taurus. Listen, them Tauruses is a trip. My sister a Taurus. They a nasty piece of work when they gotta be, you heard me? Not as bad as an Aquarius, but damn near. Lord have mercy. I don't even know what to say. Anyway, I'm just going to be quiet. Nordic said, "Goodbye, little Wosie. Goodbye." Yes, he popped her in the back. Treacherous. That's fucked up. Damn. But I'm glad she dead and gone. Because, yes, we say don't have to worry about Wosie now. Her dead. Yes, her is dead. One less slow bopper for Christ. Child, she was an angry little bird, wasn't she? Ooh, wait. Child, listen. Oh, you a Taurus too, Kate? What the hell? Wait, no. That's an Aries, right? Child, I don't. Wait, what day is that? It's Lord have mercy. No. That's a Taurus. Exactly the day. Oh my God, Lord, listen. No, that's a Taurus. Lord have mercy. Yeah, I don't want that type of love either, but Wosie had to die. She wasn't gonna let Messiah go. Yes, April 28th is a Taurus. I know. I had a moment. I had a brain fart for a second. Yes, April 28th is a Taurus, child. Listen. Yes, yes, yes. Lord, hamburger and french fries. This is a mess. Oh, you about to fix that? Well, can you fix it quietly? We'd like to, you know, thank you. Sorry, y'all. Talking to my son. All right, let me get this next time stamp together, child, because I was only supposed to come out here and give y'all help us two chapters, and then that was it. But we here now, so let's keep on going. Y'all ain't shit. All of y'all at home clapping together in unison like a bunch of damn seals. Oh, my God. Here we go. Chapter 3. Ethic? He didn't even lift his head. He pressed it into his bald fist as he leaned forward over Morgan's bed. "You need sleep. You've been awake for days. I can have the nurses set up a cot for you." "I can't," he said. "I can't sleep, baby. If she opens her eyes, she gotta see me. It's important. I need her to know I'm here." Alani placed a hand to his shoulder, then another, and then squeezed. He was so tense, his entire back was locked. The structure of him was so strong that it felt like she was trying to knead boulders. All the pressures of their world were balanced on his shoulders. He was balancing so much that it felt like he would fumble. He had fumbled with Morgan, with his daughter. He hadn't seen this coming. She rubbed his neck, his shoulders. "She knows, Ethic. I promise you, she knows. Can you at least eat something for me?" "I'm not hungry," he answered. "Where are the kids?" "I sent them home with Nanny," she whispered. "I hope that's okay." He nodded. "Of course, you should go too. Doesn't make sense for all of us to stay. I can call if anything changes." "No," she whispered. "Just go home, Lenika," he snapped. "I'm not leaving," she whispered. She was so patient. His mood had been altered, his temperament short. And she didn't care one bit. "I'm staying as long as it takes. I'm staying. She needs you. You need someone too, though. and I'm not leaving. He lifted his head from the bed and opened his arms to her, pulling her into his lap. I can't even remember how I survived before you. Shit hurts so bad, I'm barely functioning. I don't mean to be short with you. I know, baby, she whispered. Don't worry about me. This isn't about me. I know. She looked him in his eyes, soft fingers rubbing the sides of his face. I'm so full of faith that I know she's going to wake up, Ezra. You don't know God like I know God. That's my nigga, and he's got you. I promise. Ethic gave up a reluctant smile, licking his lips, then licking hers, running his tongue over her bottom lip like it was dry. He was responsible for its lubrication. Sorry, I'm over here choking, child, because that sounded really special. They showed love in the oddest ways, like they had run out of ways to express how they felt, so they were forced to make up new shit. Alani kissed him. The amount of guilt that pressed down on his soul was overwhelming because he had been through this with Morgan before, the depression. Those days were so long ago that he almost forgot they had occurred. After Raven died, the grief had been so heavy that it had drowned his entire house. The only thing that had warned him that Morgan's grief was greatest were the razor blades he had found under her bed one day. She had stolen three of his and hidden them there. When his maid had discovered them, Ethic had been devastated. Questioning Morgan had taken all his courage. He'd taken her for ice cream, just the two of them, and then placed them on the table. She'd been just 12 years old when she broke down in that shop. Tears of embarrassment and grief poured out of her that day. He was hurt behind Raven's death, but Morgan's pain was incomparable. They had tried to manage it for years until that day. What are these for, baby girl? He had asked. Her lip had trembled so violently. He already knew the answer. She didn't even have to speak it. She was going to kill herself with them. Morgan had spent 3 years in therapy, three long, hard years of weekly sessions to get her through depression. He'd never thought those days would return. Her psychiatrist had cleared her. Her doctor had told him she was fine. But as he looked at her in this hospital bed, he realized she was anything but okay. Trauma after trauma had occurred in Moon's life. She had taken so many ills. She had said goodbye to so many people. Now she was trying to leave him. She was trying to follow them. If she dies, I'm gonna need you to take easy and Bella with you for a while, he said. Alani pulled back, brow furrowed. What? I need to hear you say you will, that you'll take care of them like they're your own. They are my own, Ethic. I love them. But what are you saying? Alani asked, her eyes prickled. Fear erupted in her chest, protesting, screaming. She needed clarity. She can't go by herself. Won't make it. You say there's a God. She won't make it to him without someone to lead her there. If she doesn't open her eyes, I gotta close mine. I gotta make sure she gets to God. Alani's chin quivered. Ezra, no, she whispered. Her face was wet. Her tears fell without permission. No, no. She was revolting against even the thought of his demise. One strong hand cupped her face, four fingers wrapped around her neck and his thumb to her cheek. He pulled her forehead to his. He swallowed the lump in his throat and she could see his despair. She was witnessing the undoing of a king, the weakening of a gangster. His child was dying and Alani knew that it felt like to want to die too. If anything happens to you, I will not make it. You can't talk like this. I'll die, Ethic. I will. Mo dies, you die, I die. Then what? Those babies grow up without anyone. They need you. I need you. So Mo has to wake up. She just has to open her eyes and save us all. You can't lead Mo to God. You don't know him. I know you're not all the way there yet because you wouldn't be giving up right now. You'd have faith. If you go, I go because I've got to make sure you get there. No, she just gotta wake up. She is going to wake up. Ethic lifted his other hand to hold her entire face. His somber filled the entire room. Alani was the sunshine he had been waiting on for years. The storm that had wrecked his life for as long as he could remember had finally cleared the day she had walked him into that church. But it didn't last long. As soon as they had gotten their stride, found their way, Morgan had lost hers, and the happiness he had worked so hard for was snatched once again. He pressed his forehead to Alani's. Take care of my kids. A sob destroyed her. There was finality in his statement, like his mind was already made up and Alani was devastated. The door opened, forcing the couple apart as a doctor entered the room. Alani stood from Ethic's lap and turned away from the doctor, wiping her eyes. She could barely pull herself together. How's our girl? The doctor asked. I'm waiting on you to tell me. She hasn't done anything yet. I'm holding her hand all day, talking to her every minute. No movement, no muttering, nothing. I need you to tell me something, Doc, Ethic said. He was almost pleading. We found out why her heartbeat has been irregular, the doctor said. Ethic tapped Alani's bottom and she lifted. We ran a full blood panel on Morgan. She's pregnant, Mr. Okafor, about 18 weeks along. Ethic's head turned to Morgan, then to the doctor, then back to Morgan. He stood, swiping a hand down his head as he turned away from the hospital bed. She's pregnant, he uttered. A baby, he whispered in disbelief. Mo is pregnant. That one came out in utter wonder, barely audible. I'ma kill him. I'ma kill him. I'ma fucking kill him. Ezra, Alani spoke. He leaned against the wall, his fist acting as the barrier between his head and the plaster. He bit his knuckle and turned back towards Morgan. Is the baby okay? His heartbeat is so strong, we thought she had an arrhythmia, the doctor informed. There could be some developmental issues because of the carbon monoxide ingestion, but we won't know that until birth. But he's strong. He's holding on tight in there. We're starting to see fluctuation in her brain activity as well, and that's a good sign. Right now, it's just a waiting game. We're waiting for her to wake up to determine what type of brain function she has. Ethic leaned over Morgan and planted lips to her forehead. Fight, Morgan. Beep, beep, beep. Morgan's eyes felt heavy. It was like someone was pulling down her lids, trying to keep her in the darkness that she was fighting. She fluttered them open. Bella, they closed. Morgan's eyes lifted again, but they were so damn heavy. Aria? Come on, baby girl. You can do it. Wake up. I'm right here waiting for you, Mo. Open those pretty eyes. That was Ethic's voice, and she felt tension in her chest. She wanted to cry. He sounded wounded, like he'd been crying, like there was something blocking his throat. Fear, worry. Morgan heard them both, and as she fought against the invisible force, pushing her eyelids closed, she opened them, because her father was waiting for her to, because she heard it in his voice that he needed her to. I'll get a doctor. That was Alani's voice. Bitch, Mo thought, still hating the idea of her, still loathing the fact that Ethic had been pulled out of the dark that they once shared. Now Morgan was standing alone in the grief of losing Raven. She closed her eyes once more, fluttering them again to see easy. Her eyes scanned the room before rolling closed again. Frustrations mounted in her because she couldn't keep them open long enough to set her sights on the one person she wanted to see. He wasn't there. Messiah, where was he? Gone. Messiah's gone. The thought made her want to close her eyes forever. She remembered why she had done this to herself. He was gone from her life, and she didn't want to live a life without him in it. She didn't want to raise a child alone without a father, but there was no way that Messiah could be a part of her life after what had been revealed. So she wanted to see her daddy. She wanted to die so she could be with Benny Atkins because he was the only one who could triage her broken heart. She needed him, but he was dead because of Mizan. Messiah was Mizan's brother. She wanted to be dead too, and it would all just go away. Mo, I'm right here. Come back for me, Mo. Morgan, wake up. Baby girl, just wake up for me. Poor Ethic, I love you so much. I'm so sorry. One second, y'all. I don't even know if I, Oh, yeah, that was a break in the chapter. Okay, I'm sorry. I thought I had girl so wrapped up in the damn story. Anyway. Okay. She felt cold fingers open her eyes and the face of a white man in a white lab coat hovered over her. Get that fucking light out of my face, she thought, as if he could hear her thoughts. He released her eyelids and the darkness cloaked her again. Give her some time. She should wake up soon. When she's ready, she'll come too, and we can assess the damage then, the doctor said. The damage is monumental. I'll never be the same. Morgan laid there hearing, feeling, but not waking. She couldn't wake. The fog she was in was too dense. She couldn't quite see through it, but she could listen. She heard it all. It was an odd place to be, stuck between breathing and not, wedged between life and death, in limbo. She could almost hear her other family, Raven, and her parents calling her to them. She almost wanted to just go, let those eyes stay closed. But then there was Ethic. She heard him the loudest calling her back. She'd had 6 years with Benny, a time with Ethic double that, and then some. He was truly the most important man in her life. She had never loved anyone more. Then Messiah had come into her world. She loved him that much, enough to consider going against her family to be with him, if it had ever come to that. And he hadn't been willing to do the same. He hadn't defied his family. He had been there to avenge his family. It could only mean one thing. He didn't love her at all. She's trying, Ethic. That's a good sign. If this bitch don't get out my room, Morgan thought, annoyed by the sound of Alani's voice, she's gonna take him away from me. She's gonna make him stop loving my sister. Get out! I know, he answered. Shit just can't ever be right, you know? Like it's a constant juggling act. When I didn't have you, my kids were straight. Now you're here and Mo is in this fucking hospital bed. It's just constant loss. I'm constantly dropping the ball. It makes me feel like I'm choking. She's laying here fighting for her life because of me. It feels like I can't breathe. I'll breathe for you, Alani answered. I love you, Ezra. I'm in love with you and everything attached to you. I'll breathe for every single one of you. This isn't your fault. It isn't hers either. Sometimes life just gets so hard. Something about those words and the way they sounded made Morgan's heart lurch inside her chest. The monitors around her blared, going crazy at Morgan's internal reaction. For so long, Morgan had to discern the world around her without the sense of hearing. Now she was discerning it with the sense alone, because her eyes just wouldn't cooperate. Morgan heard sincerity in Alani. Alani knew that feeling of losing so much that you wanted to check out, and Morgan could hear it. Morgan heard commitment in Alani's voice. Like no matter what Ethic did or how hard it got, Alani would never leave. Not again. They were past that point. Morgan wished she could have that with Messiah. Dread filled the room for 48 more tortuous hours before Morgan was able to muster the strength to open her eyes. Mo? Aria's face was the first face that blurred in front of her. Morgan's eyes were filled with emotion, but she wasn't crying. It was like she had been submerged underwater and was trying to see through the water that remained in her eyes. Girl, thank fucking God, Aria exclaimed. Now I can kill you. Morgan's lip trembled, and she felt Aria grip one of her hands. She tried to speak, but the endotracheal tube that ran down her throat stopped her. It was choking her, and Morgan panicked. Her eyes widened in terror, and she gagged on the tube as the machines around her went haywire. Somebody help! We need help! Aria screamed. A nurse rushed in, and Morgan cried, tears streaming from her eyes as terror seized her. You're fine, Morgan, the nurse said. Her voice was calm, and she grabbed Morgan's face, staring her in the eyes. You're fine. Don't fight it. This tube was breathing for you. This tube kept you alive. I'm going to remove it, okay? Morgan squeezed her eyes shut and nodded. Okay, it'll hurt just a bit. Your throat will feel raw, but you're fine, sweetheart. Your family's here. They're downstairs getting food. They'll be so happy you're awake. Just stay calm. The nurse turned to Aria. Come hold her hand. Aria rushed to the bedside and laced her fingers with Mo's. Morgan deadpanned on Aria. She had never seen fear in her before, but it lived in her stare. The nurse pulled the tube out of her mouth, and it seemed to go on forever until finally Morgan felt relief. Just breathe, sweetheart, the nurse said. Morgan's breaths were shallow, and her entire chest burned, but she was breathing on her own, and that was progress. It was a miracle. 1 second, y'all. I'm going to have your family paged. They're right in the cafeteria. You take care of her until I get back, the nurse said. Aria nodded, clearing her own tears from her eyes. Bitch, I want to kill you, but I know I'd miss you, so I can't do shit but fucking cry, Aria chastised. Morgan laughed through a sob that escaped from her. Everyone was so damn worried, Mo, Aria said seriously. Morgan opened her mouth to speak, but the words jumbled in her throat. She wasn't strong enough yet. The tube had been down her throat for so long that scar tissue had begun to form around it. Morgan's eyes flooded. Oh, Mo, it's okay. Just breathe. You don't even have to talk. Just breathe, Mo, Aria urged. A mixture of embarrassment and gratitude filled Morgan. She had never had a friend like Aria. She represented a sisterhood, a level of loyalty that Mo was only used to receiving from family. If it were up to Morgan, she would have never divulged this to Aria. She would have kept it a secret, pretended like everything was fine so that Aria couldn't harvest the information to use against her later. Looking at Aria in this moment, Morgan saw pure love, a genuine concern that reassured Morgan that there was no judgment taking place. It was only love. Aria had been terrified to lose Morgan, and the revelation that their friendship was indeed true made Morgan's heart so tender that it felt like pain. Bella walked in, eyes glued to her phone. Morgan parted her lips, eyes burning with tears as she tried to call her name. It hurt too badly to get it out, but Bella's head snapped in her direction at just the attempt. The iPhone fell from her hands and she didn't even care. She rushed to Morgan's side. Her chin quivered as she crashed into Morgan, clinging to her as she cried. "You hurt me so bad, Mo," Bella sobbed. "Everything fell apart without you." Morgan held on to Bella. Instant remorse filled her. She hadn't thought of Bella when she was sitting in that car. She hadn't thought of anyone except herself. The sight of them, these sisters, was so emotional that Aria rolled tear-filled eyes to the ceiling to stop them from cascading down her cheeks. "Don't do that to me. You can't do that, Mo, like ever," Bella cried. Morgan caressed Bella's hair soothingly as they wept. Morgan pulled back. "I'm so sorry, B," Morgan signed. I forgot she could sign. Right, her finger's about to be working overtime now. "I'm running down on Messiah. I'm beating his whole ass," Aria whispered as she sniffled and dabbed her eyes. Morgan's eyes widened and she shook her head, panicking, frantic. "No, please, Aria, please don't say anything. You can't. Not to Issa either. I don't want anyone else to know," Morgan signed. "Please. What is she saying?" Aria asked Bella. "She doesn't want you to tell him or Issa. You have to keep it a secret," she says, Bella interpreted. "You're in here because of him. This is his fault. What about the baby?" Aria protested. Morgan sucked in air, freezing, fear-filled. "The doctor told us, Mo," Aria revealed. "Ethics been out of his mind worried about you. You've been out for a long time." "How long?" Morgan signed, confused. It hadn't felt like that much time had passed. Bella's lip quivered, and she hesitated to answer. "How long, B?" "Almost 2 weeks, Mo," Bella answered sadly. "And he hasn't come once," she signed. "What is she saying?" Aria asked. "She's asking about Messiah," Bella whispered. "I tried to call him. Ethic tried to call him. He's not taking our calls. Issa isn't even taking my calls. I'm not sure, but I think they're gone, Mo," Aria whispered. Morgan broke. Her head collapsed against the pillow and her hands lifted to her face as she sobbed. "Gone? How could he be gone? How could he leave her? How could he really pick up and walk out of her life after promising that he would never desert her? She didn't give a fuck how mad she was, how deceitful he had been, how off track they had gotten. Messiah could cheat, rob, kill, steal, and Morgan would be mad as hell, but she would never leave. They were supposed to hate each other until they loved one another again, fight until they felt like fucking, but never leave. He was never supposed to leave her. Morgan's soul was snatched from her body, her love, her heart, her strength, the father of her child, and the man she would have died for, the man she would have killed for, the man she had spoken first for, had left her. She wished she had never opened her eyes. If he was gone, there was no point in being here at all. Ethic entered the room, and both Aria and Bella moved out of the way as he rushed over to her. He removed his jacket and climbed into bed with Morgan, wrapping his arms around her and kissing the top of her head as she sobbed. Witnessing such turmoil was enough to bring Alani to tears as she lingered in the doorway with Easy at her side. Such unbelievable grief filled the room that it choked her. "Come on, guys. Let's give your dad a minute with Morgan," Alani said, voice weakened by the emotional sight. "Aria, Morgan needs a little time with her father, okay?" Aria nodded. "Of course. Yeah, I'll come back tomorrow once things have settled. Oh, and Mo?" Morgan looked up, wiping her eyes as she tried to control her cries. "I snuck into your courses and took finals for you. I knew you were waking up, and when you did, no way was I going to let my girl have to redo freshman year. My ass probably flunked them bitches anyway, but you can't say I didn't try." Aria winked and elicited a much-needed laugh from Morgan, amused through the sadness. She got a snicker out of it as well, before waving, hugging Alani and Bella, and then giving Easy a high five before exiting. Mo watched everyone leave the room except Ethic. He just held her, rubbing her shoulder and kissing the top of her head. "It hurts so bad," she signed. "I know," Ethic answered, signing his response. "It hurts because you're living, Mo. Life hurts sometimes. You have a lot of life ahead of you, baby girl. But you gotta be here to get to the good part. You gotta be here." His voice broke, and Morgan clung to him tighter. "I'm so sorry." She tried to speak. It came out in a whisper, a pained whisper, and then a parade of sobs followed behind. "Me too, Mo," Ethic replied. "He's my Zahn's brother. I didn't know. How could I not know?" she sighed. We just learned that part. That part's no good. We've had a lot of hate for Maison for a lot of years, and I reacted off that hate, but he's this baby's father, too, Ethic said. He's shown us other parts, Mo. I can't have this baby, Morgan sighed. Her hands shook so violently that she could barely express herself. Ethic turned stern eyes to her. No way was he allowing Morgan to play that game. Alani had taken him through that game. It was a painful deceit, and nobody won in the end. You don't keep a man from his kid, Morgan, and you don't make decisions about a man's kid without involving him. Ever. There's no undoing that. I know that hurt. That's not happening, Ethic said. But he's Maison's brother, Morgan protested. I can't. Ethic reached for her hands, stopping her from signing, cupping her hands in his. He brought them to his lips and bowed his head. He was so fucking grateful, so indebted. She had opened her eyes and was functioning. They had problems to solve, but she was alive to do it. That's all that mattered. He didn't want her worrying, didn't want her to give up again. Morgan reclaimed one of her hands as he gripped the other, and she rubbed the top of his head. She knew he was crying because he trembled. Head bowed because he didn't want to show her this weakness. He cried, and Morgan soothed him while tears flooded her. She had no idea he would be this hurt. She had never been more remorseful in her life. Hurting Ethic ruined her. He sniffed and released her, clearing his face with one hand, pinching the bridge of his nose, then swiping one hand down his entire face. He sucked in a deep breath. Before he was Maison's brother, before we knew, who was he to you, to this family? He was my family. She sighed, still crying. Ethic sat on the edge of her bed and cupped her face, clearing her tears with his thumbs. We wanted this, Ethic, to start a family together. We were going to have everything, be everything to each other, and now he's nothing, Morgan sighed. Ethic felt the turmoil in her soul because it filled his, too. What was he to do? How could he reconcile this for her? What actions could he take as a family that didn't disrespect Raven's memory? I take it Messiah doesn't know, Ethic said. I taught him everything he knows, and I find it hard to believe that even I could keep him away if he knew you were pregnant. Morgan shook her head. I was waiting to tell him, and then everything went so wrong. I can't keep this baby. You can, Mo, if that's what you want. You're not obligated to make any decision on anyone else's behalf but your own. Not Messiah's, not mine. Not Raven's. This is your body. If you decide to keep this baby, I'll be here for you through every single hard day. I'll come to every appointment, spoil you through every pain, because you're my daughter and I love you. I'm gonna hold you down even when a knucklehead ass boy breaks your heart. You're not alone. I loved him so much, Ethic, Morgan whispered. Her insides burned with the words, but she didn't care. She needed to speak those words because they were fact, nothing but true. She had loved Messiah Williams. Ethic nodded. I know. I want to prepare you, baby girl. The doctors think there might be some damage. Damage? Morgan's voice was childlike as she lifted sad eyes to his. The lack of oxygen. It might have hurt the baby. No one will know for sure until this baby is born, but I just want to prepare you. What did I do? She cried as her lip quivered. You tried to run from pain, but the only way to deal with pain is to feel it. Get through it, Mo. I'm right here to help you find your way when you get lost. You hear me? He asked. She held him tighter and nodded. Ethic sat there with her as she cried. When she fell asleep, he lifted from the bed. Rage coursed through him as he stepped into the hallway, pulling his cell phone from his pocket. Alani waited in the hallway, sitting in a chair against the wall, as she read to Bella and Easy. When she saw him, she handed the book off to Bella. Keep going. I'll be right back, she said. She walked over to Ethic. He ended his phone call in frustration. I gotta go. After Messiah? Alani asked. Ethic pinched the bridge of his nose, his jaw flexed, and he gritted his teeth. Tension lived in his every expression. I'm trying real hard for you, but he paused, pointing a stern finger at Moe's door and then swiping one hand over his mouth and finessing his beard. He fucking, what he's done to her, he's fucking Maison's. Ethic was coursing with ill intent. His appetite for murder was restored. Alani feared this side of him, and her heart galloped as she saw it take over the loving man she knew. She reached for his face. Hey, she whispered. Ethic gave her his focus. I'm gonna kill that nigga, baby. I got to. I fucking... Ezra, she said, and the hurt he heard in her voice jarred him. Eye to eye, forehead to forehead, she whispered. Forgiveness is for the strong. Be strong, Ethic. Like it or not, Messiah and Morgan have a baby on the way. He's your family now. If I can forgive you, you can forgive him. He was lurking, waiting, and he clearly loves you, Alani said. He clearly loves Mo. He had every opportunity to hurt you, and he's resisted all these years. He's been around for years, Ethic, and he never struck. He fell in love with you. It's easy to do. So easy to do, she said, as she rubbed the side of his face and gazed at him in concern, while amazement, wonder over the type of man he was danced in her eyes. You mean something to Messiah, and he means something to you. That's why the betrayal hurts, because it came from someone you love. We talked about this. You can't be judge, jury, and executioner. Morgan tried to kill herself over that boy. She loves him. And if you kill him, she'll never forgive that. So you find him and you fix it. That's how you protect your daughter in this circumstance. You go get her man and let him know it's okay for him to come back. Family is fucked up sometimes. It's not always perfect, but you make it fucking work. You're going to make this work for her. But Raven, he's not his brother, Ethic, Alani interrupted. He didn't kill Raven. Same way I didn't hurt Morgan. We can't help who we're related to. That hit home. Alani heard the bat connect to the ball as she hit the shit out the park. Recognition shone in his eyes, and he entangled his fingers in her hair as he gripped her head, kissing her so deeply. I'm lucky to have you. You know that? He asked as he kissed her lips, a quick peck because he no longer had to pull her all out of her, with every kiss, because she was readily available to him now. Ew, Daddy, Easy said as he covered his eyes from the chair he sat in. Alani chuckled. I'll be back, okay? He said. She nodded and pecked him back, unable to help herself. We'll be here, she whispered. I know you got to meet your professor. I won't be long, he said. I know Morgan isn't fond of me, but I'm not going anywhere, Ethic. Fuck that book and my professor. Take as long as you need. I can reschedule. This time a deeper kiss, and Alani swooned, accepting his tongue into her mouth. Daddy, so embarrassing. The protest belonged to Bella this time. Alani turned from him, blushing. Little girl, mind your business, she teased as Ethic chased her face with his lips, kissing her again. Come here, baby. Let me embarrass her some more. Alani kissed him again and again. He moaned. Daddy, Ezra shouted. Alani laughed as he bent her backwards, kissing her longer, just because his kids were protesting. I'm raising a bunch of fucking player haters, he said as he kissed her entire face, moving from her forehead to her cheeks to her neck, then to the tip of her nose. Alani hollered in laughter. This felt so good. It felt easy, and she was so grateful for the love he gave. Hurry back. We need you. I need you. He bit the lobe of her ear gently, and then he was gone. He had a score to settle with a young'un he should hate, but somehow mixed in the hate was a little bit of love that was keeping Messiah breathing. He just had to find him. And that's the end of that chapter. I don't even, this is, no, she a crazy ass Taurus. Yeah. Child, listen, a ghetto love story indeed. Oh, child, I'm trying to make sure I didn't miss nothing. All right, so y'all, I think I'm going to stop right here. Because y'all just got like 10 chapters, 11 chapters from me earlier. No, 10. Y'all got 10 chapters from me earlier. And then now I just gave y'all three more. And that's it. No, I can't deny it. It is very good, Marvel. It really is. It's very good. Yeah, but... Child, I would have to be up here all night to finish it, because this thing is, it says I got 5 hours and 50 minutes left in the book. Shit, I know you lying. I love y'all, but girl, you take them damn baby bottles and put them in the freezer and then put them somewhere else and have fun, you heard me? Look at this here for some of don't be selfish, socky shit. Y'all just got 10 chapters earlier today. Girl, what the fuck? Y'all all better go to hell. Strapped to a BP tanker fucking with me. Shit. I gave y'all 10 chapters earlier. And y'all wasn't supposed to get these three until tomorrow. I came back out here tonight just to be sweet. Look at honestly, Kay. You niggas is trifling. Oh my God. The sippers and speakers are so fucking spoiled. Yeah, it was 10. It was 10 chapters. I read y'all chapter 12 to chapter 22 or through chapter 22. I know you lie. Shit. Technically, it was 11 chapters. Shit. That was 11. And then y'all just got a synopsis and three chapters from me. Child, listen, I don't give a damn. I done left niggas sad because they couldn't get that motherfucker away. I don't give a damn. Now, God. Hell, I got a husband sad right now. You heard me? Because I said, Shit, you better ask some goddamn about it. No, God. No. But this was fun, though, y'all, for real. Y'all, it's 7:41. Y'all still got a lot of evening left. But I just wanted to come out here and break y'all off a little bit of something, because I was nosy, too. I really just wanted to know if Morgan was going to live. And now that I know, we'll pick this up tomorrow, child. We'll pick it up tomorrow. And, yeah, we'll put a nice little dent in it, because how many chapters did I say? I think this book is, let me see. This book is 23 chapters. So we'll put a nice dent in it tomorrow. Yeah. We'll come back tomorrow. Y'all just be looking out for y'all little notification, child. Y'all got to, I got to put my feet up, shit. Oh, thank you, Nordic. Yes, I know y'all be back tomorrow. Thank you. All right, so listen, child, I'm getting ready to go relax and cool out a little bit because, listen, let me tell y'all something. Just real quick, do y'all know the amount of weird shit that you can find on Instagram and YouTube? And like, I don't even really be fucking with Instagram and like that no more. I used to, you know, when I was all about my personal page. But y'all, it be some hilarious shit on Instagram and YouTube, child. Listen, I mean, like, you know, because like you fool around, you know, and try to stay in the black sector and, you know, try to support your people. But child, listen. It's black people in other sectors of YouTube, you know, not just in, you know, the Negroidian sector. You know, you got to branch out. Child, I watched a black lady today who lives in a tiny home in North Carolina. I was amazed at this little fucking tiny home that this lady lives in. I was like, oh my God, it's just her and her little bitty dog. Me personally, I could have done without that little weird looking ass dog. It was one of them hot dog dogs. And it was black and gray. I said, child, that's her buddy. And if that little dog passed away, she gonna be a sad ass. But bless her heart and all her parts, child. I mean, I just really, I had a really good time watching those little tiny home things. And then, of course, I'd be watching, you know, the other little videos. Nah, don't have me stalking your page. No, God, I don't really do nothing on Instagram, child. I just, post my little stuff that, you know, let y'all know that I'm getting ready to go live and shit. I ain't even done that in a couple days. I really haven't. But I need to step outside and get a little bit of sun before the sun go down. But y'all, listen, this is Texas. Let me tell y'all something. Right now, at this very moment, it is 95 degrees outside and it feels like 110. Earlier today, it was 100 degrees outside and it felt like 115. That's what the thermometer said. It doesn't lie. It never does. It is hotter than a well digger's ass clad in leather down here. It don't make no damn sense, but I still need my sun because, well, vitamin D is important for black folks, and we get that from the sun. So take your ass outside and get you a little bit of sunshine, child, if it's still shining in your area. Just 5 or 10 minutes. That's all you need. You ain't even got to move, because if you move, you might burst into fucking flames. But just just be still and sip your water, child. That's all you got to do. Yes, and it's humid as fuck outside. Yes. It's humid. It's humid, humid, humid. Oh, you talking about my YouTube thing? Yeah, I'm going to go live tomorrow. And I'm going to start pretty early because I want us to put a nice little dent in this tomorrow. Because I told y'all, I want us to finish both of these books this week. I really do. I'm serious about that. Because I'm done with this nigga after that. Okay? Like, we're not reading The Butterfly and we ain't doing The Butterfly. Well, we might do The Butterfly, but we ain't going to read The Butterfly over here. No, we're not doing that. Sorry, Ethic, but go ahead, sir. No, we're not doing that. So, all right, now, I want y'all to be good this evening, and I appreciate y'all coming over here and listening to me read out loud. Yes, you got to do The Butterfly, child. That's good. Helps you get that V. That y'all better do these dances, child, because they exercise your muscles and your gut. And then that way you can sit on it and look down and see what you, anyway, my whole point is, y'all make sure y'all look both ways as y'all travel the highways and byways of the YouTube verse, okay? Yeah, well, you can do the Tootsie Roll too, child. Listen, just get your tennis skirt popping. You heard me? Get your tennis skirt popping. All right? So listen, thank you, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator, darling. I truly appreciate you. All right? Y'all ain't gonna have me up here talking because it'd be 8:30 and I'll still be talking and I could have just read the next damn chapter. No, God, we out of here. All right? Make sure y'all look both ways before y'all cross the street because there's loose drivers at the wheel and I love y'all and I want y'all to make it back here in one piece. All right? If you haven't already, okay, like the video on your way out the door. And if you do nothing else this evening, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye y'all. Let me tell y'all something for those of y'all that are still here. I stopped the music. Let me tell y'all something. I wish I could sit up here all night and talk to y'all. I'd be so sad leaving y'all. But for real, I gotta go. All right. So for those of y'all that are feeling like, damn, I wish you would just stay live a little bit longer. I want to, but I can't, y'all. I seriously can't because we'll be up here all night talking about shit that don't even matter. Seriously. I would love to do nothing but that, but no God, y'all. All right? So y'all go ahead and y'all have a good evening, all right? Seriously, I'm gone. Love y'all. Bye.